At this time, and do appreciate this opportunity. We've kind of told you, I guess, a little bit in times past, a little bit how we study, and God puts something on our heart, a thought comes to our mind, we just kind of write it down and put a note down, and then see where God wants to go with that, and trust the Lord. So I'll just give you all a heads up that I got several notes wrote down. So if the Lord lets us tarry that long, maybe there's a few things that's on my heart that I'll need to tell you. But I'll trust the Lord with this hour, in this moment, this time. We don't know what'll happen tomorrow, and I hope that everybody's got everything worked out with God today. I do. I hope that you know the Lord, the Holy Spirit's with you today, and you've known Him, and there's a closeness with you, and the Lord, He said, draw nigh to me, and I will draw nigh to you. What a promise that is. Listen, that's not just any old body. That's the King of Kings that's saying, draw nigh to me, come to me, right? Come to me. You can know me, right? And I'll draw nigh to you. What a blessing that is to know God and have the relationship with Him. And I think so many times that through our culture and our life that we lose sight that there is a relationship that you have with God that only comes through and by the Holy Spirit of God, that He can come into your heart and make His abode in your life. And it changes your desires. It changes your direction. It makes you sorry for doing wrong. It teaches you to repent and turn from your ways to come to God. And you get to rejoice at the throne of Jesus. What a blessing that is. What a blessing. Listen, I want to throw this out there. It's just something on my heart. I heard a preacher, and he done a wonderful job preaching this week. And I won't get the words exactly right, but I want you to know this. If we're in a place to where sin doesn't bother us, we're in the wrong place, aren't we? We're in the wrong place. When we look out in the world and abortion doesn't bother you anymore, your mind's not in the right place. Where our own personal sins, whether it's lying or stealing or cheating or fornication or adultery, all that, if that doesn't bother you, something's wrong. Something's wrong. And we need to teach our children, this is wrong, and God is right. Oh, listen, I'm not telling you these things to be grievous. The Bible doesn't tell you these things to be grievous. But He loves us, doesn't He? He cares about us. And He wants us to know the joy of His salvation. What a blessing it is. Oh, listen, I want to read this scripture. I got so blessed. I read this scripture, and what a blessing it is. And I'll just give you this chapter there in Psalms. It's the homework, this whole chapter. It's the 46th chapter of Psalms. And I'm going to read just the first verse, because it's such a blessing to me. That I read a little bit when we were studying this in a commentary in it. And tradition says, so take this with a grain of salt, that Luther, when trouble would come and persecution would come, would want to sing this psalm. And what a blessing it is. It says in the first verse, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. What a blessing that is. And I'm going to stop right there. And y'all can read the rest of this, but the verse that is on our heart more than anything today is the 10th verse. It says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. What a blessing it is. We're going to pray. Dear Lord, we come before you, and as the scripture said, we just want to be still before you, to know you better today, that your presence would be in our heart. And Lord, we've been blessed today. We know that you love us and you care about us. And Lord, we thank you, dear Jesus, Lord, for letting us worship. What an honor it is to get to kneel before your throne. The invitation that we spoke about last week, what a great invitation it is to come now and let us reason together. Though our sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. You went in ahead and said that if we be willing and obedient, we can eat the good of the land, dear God. Oh, but listen, how gracious, Lord, you are that you would make that invitation to us. I'm as little as I can be, and I need your help, and I need your mercy. And Lord, I'm thankful for your love. How gracious you are today. I pray, Lord, that you would speak the words that need to be spoken today, dear God. Lord, that I wouldn't get in your way one little bit. Lord, that you'd put this in order the way you see fit. We love you, and we know that you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Word of God says in this psalm, be still and know that I am God. And it's just a simple little scripture there, is it? It's pretty easy to remember, isn't it? That we can go out through the rest of this week and every part of your day, you can say, just be still and know that I'm God. That I'm God. He's my Lord. And see, I have this, I guess this reason that it was on my heart is before we even started preaching today. That this relationship that we have with God, that we can walk with Him and we can talk with Him and we can be near to Him. I can be with Him in the car. I can be with Him at church. I can be with Him at home. He's my Lord. He's my King. And He's proven to me over and over and over that He loves me. That He cares about me. And yes, that does bring boldness to our heart. It's good to know that you're loved by the grace of God, isn't it? It's good to know that when everybody else doesn't seem to understand where you're at, and maybe sometimes when you're lonely and afraid, that God is still God and He loves you. Oh, and Jesus died on the cross to pay for our sins. Oh, what a blessing this. You know, that's the biggest need that we have in our life, was that we are sinners and we need a great Savior. We do. As you go back through the Bible and you read a little bit of the history of Israel and you read about Jesus when He came and how they wanted to take Him and put Him on the earthly throne, but He refused that, didn't He? And He went to the cross instead. Why? Because the biggest need that we had in this life wasn't to have an earthly king, but to have our sins forgiven. Right? Because without your sins being forgiven, you're on the way to hell, aren't you? Right? Everybody. Say, Kevin, what about all these powerful politicians? What about all these people that give away a bunch of money? What about all these? They need Jesus just like you and just like I. We all need Jesus. We all need grace. We all need help. And it's real, church. I want to tell you this. If the Holy Spirit is not in your heart, the Bible teaches me, you're none of His. You're not saved. You can say all the right words. You can come up here and try to get the preacher to save you. But you need Jesus. The preacher can't save you. Mom and dad can't save you. Friends can't save you. You got to go to Jesus. Well, how'd I go to Him? With a broken heart. With a contrite spirit. Knowing that He's God. I'll get to the scripture in a minute. But He's God, isn't He? He's God. He says, be still. Stop what you're doing. Stop right now. I want you to think about this. Be still and know that I am God. To know it in your heart. Oh, doesn't it remind you of the scriptures in the 8th chapter of Romans that we know these things, don't we? that we are assured these things, that we are convinced that neither height nor depth nor principalities, that all these things shall separate us from the love of God. How gracious God is that we can know that in our heart. Oh, listen, as we look into Scripture specifically and think about what all was going on and the praise of God that's in this chapter here. It talked about the enemies of God, those that had brought themselves up and lifted themselves up and fought against God. That someday, oh, the Bible teaches us over in Philippians, I believe it is somewhere around the second chapter, that every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, right? So listen, you don't get a pass to say, well, I'm not religious. I wasn't raised that way, so that doesn't affect me. No, I want to tell the whole world, that you are going to stand before God, and give an account for the deeds that you have done in this life. Everybody is. And if you don't have Jesus, you're as lost as you can be. As lost as you. We need Jesus. Be still and know that I am God. Oh, Jesus said it this way in the last chapter of Matthew. I think it's around the 28th chapter there in Matthew. When he gives us what we call the Great Commission to go out into all the world, baptizing them, right? In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and the Holy Ghost. He goes on to say we should teach and all the things that we should do about Christ and give this message out, this gospel message. But he goes on and gives you this great comfort. He said, at the very first of that, he says, all power is given unto me. All power is given unto me. I'm going to read that scripture real quick, if y'all will give me a chance. And Jesus came and spake to them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And listen, here's what it says. Listen. And lo, I am with you always. Praise God. Always, even unto the end of the world. I'm with you. Do you believe that? Can you say amen to that in your heart? Is God with you today? Do you know that, right? Oh, I'm going to ask you, this is something personal. Have you had conviction in your heart this week? Have you been able to rejoice in the goodness of God? Have you recognized His mercy in your life? Can you get on your knees right now and be able to pray for your dear loved ones and know that your heart is right with God by His grace and His mercy? Do you know that? Down in your heart, be still and know that I'm God. I want to tell you this, all these that have rejected God throughout history are going to bow before Him. They're going to bow before Him. It's real, church. It's real. It's as sure as what you see today, what you can feel today. This is going to happen. Be still and know Him. Oh, my mind went this way. It was personal to me. As we look up at the scriptures and over in a chapter of Romans and the different scriptures that you can find over in 1 John and all these, he that has begun a good work in you will continue it, right? We'll perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. God's with you, isn't He? Oh, listen, the Bible teaches us in place there in Romans where it says that we're more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. What a blessing that is. Oh, over in John, 1 John, I think it says it this way, that greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. What a blessing it is. I may have the scriptures mixed up, but the scriptures are true and they're real. God is with His people, isn't He? He's with us today. Be still and know that I'm God. I'm God. Listen, it says the heathen raged. It says in this sixth verse, the heathen raged and the kingdoms were moved. And he uttered his voice and the earth melted. That's my God. That's how big he is. Right? And this, and how gracious he is that he would make this personal, that today is the day of salvation. And now is the time that right now, through the Spirit of God and through his Holy Spirit and convict bear, you can be saved now. You can know him. You can know him. So, but Kevin, can I have my cake and eat it too? No, you can't. And I'm not going to preach. I'm just going to preach that. Can't do it. Halfway don't work. Will never work. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, he says. None. None. I don't care what society says is all right. If the Bible says it's wrong, it's wrong. It will always be wrong. You believe that? You believe that? And I'll tell you this, we don't know about tomorrow. We don't know about what's going to happen. We don't know if we have our next breath. Right now, it's time to be still and know that God is God and King of kings and Lord of lords. Today, he says to humble your heart. Right now. Right now. Oh, how gracious he is that he would invite us. Oh, I know that God, in Sunday school, it was mentioned about a vision and these visions that you read about in the Old Testament and different things that God gave, even in the New Testament, and Peter's vision and all that was going on with that. But I do want to say this to the Holy Spirit of God. The Bible teaches us without a vision, the people will perish, right? What should your vision be today? What did Jesus say? Let's go to the New Testament. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added unto you, right? The roof, the food, the raiment, the things that you need. He knows that you have need of those. Me and Marcy was talking, and he even knows. It's amazing to me. When the sparrow falls, doesn't he? He knows. He knows. And he cares about you. I'm going to close. But I have this scripture up on my heart. And it's over in 2 Kings. And I'm just going to talk about it a little bit. But in Kings, through this part, around the sixth chapter of 2 Kings, we're talking about Elisha. And in this chapter, it talks about where the axe floated and all this. But we find in this scripture here, and it's a wonderful, powerful scripture. You get a chance to read it. I just advise you to pick it up and read it. It's just a short chapter. But the king of Syria warred against Israel. And he took his men together, and he would try to, in other words, set up traps for them and find them and do all these things. But every time he would do that, he'd send his men out to do this, that God would warn Elisha, and Elisha would warn the king of Israel there. And he couldn't get them. And it worried him. And he finally, he there in his bedchamber there, the Bible says and teaches us that he came to his men. Who is against us? And who's for Israel? I want to know, basically, who's the spy that's letting them know what I'm doing? And one of them said, no, it's Elisha. Right? And he knows exactly even the secrets in your bedchamber. He knows what's going on. And he's warning them. He said, well, let's go get him. So what did he do? Right? He wasn't a man that feared God. He wanted to go get Elisha. Right? Oh, listen, Elisha stood for what was right, didn't he? He was a prophet of God. And I want to tell you this, the world does not like God's people. Never have, never will. The devil will always give you bad advice. Did you know that? Always. Always. When you're going the way of the world, you're going to get in trouble. You're going to get in trouble. So the king sent these chariots and all these army out here after him over in Dothan. And therefore, it says, therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host. And they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early, gone forth, and behold, the host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots, the servant said unto him, Alas, my master, how shall we do? He was afraid, wasn't he? Look at all the enemy. They're all around us, these horses and chariots, this army of Syria. They're all, Alas, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Oh, but listen, the servant of God, he had his confidence in the Lord, didn't he? Elisha knew that God was with him. Elisha knew that God would be with him. Oh, and Elisha looks at this, and I love this verse here, this 16th verse. Then he answered, and he said, Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. Amen. I want to tell you, church, there may be a few of us in this world, but praise God, they that be with us are greater than they that be with them in the world, aren't they? Oh, how gracious God is, that God is still with you. Be still and know that I'm God. They can bring all the armies of the world up against God, but they are a defeated foe. Amen to that. Someday, we're going to be with Jesus. Someday, we're going to know, even as we're known, someday, we're going to be with Jesus at his throne. And what mercy there is, and cry out, Worthy, worthy is the Lamb of God. How gracious he is. He is worthy, isn't he, church? He is worthy. I want to finish this. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man. And he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. Oh, church, we need to be able to see, don't we? We need to be able to see as greater as he that's in you than he that is in the world. It's real, church, and it moves you. Listen, you're not alone. Jesus Christ himself said, All power is given unto me. And he goes on and says, as we said a while ago, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Oh, listen, you know what happened? Elisha prayed and they were blinded. And he took that whole army and led them on down to the king of Israel. And he told them they could open their eyes there and they could see and they seen where they were at. And the king said, Should we slay them? He said, No, they're prisoners. Feed them. And they did. Oh, how gracious God is. I want to tell you this. I'm not a very popular preacher, and it really doesn't matter. But I want to tell you this. I love you with all my heart. And what I preach and what God puts on my heart, I tell you because I love you and I care about you. This world, I heard that I preached a message on it. Maybe sometime I will, about these jangling words that people have, these false doctrines they have. That we've come up in this world, that somehow we think that God can save us, but there is no sanctification goes on after that. That's not the way it works. Yes, by the grace of God, we're justified, right? That's those theological words that we use, I guess. We're justified by His grace because of what? Because of the blood of Calvary. Amen. But as sure as that happens in our life, it's as sure that God works in our hearts and changes our lives. Amen. Amen. One doesn't come without the other, right? One doesn't come without the other. And I want to warn you. And I want to tell you. Let's seek after Jesus. I've been happy today. I have. I've got to worship God. I hope you have. It's been real to me and it moves me. And I'm thankful that I'm a child of God. I'm thankful that I can sing the song, oh yes, I'm a child of the King. Oh, how gracious He is that I'm a part, that I can go to God and I can cry of a father, that I can give forgiveness, and I can say his mercy endureth forever, that I can say that there is a desire in my heart that I want to be close to God. How about you? How about you? I can testify that in my heart. I want to be near to God. Oh, listen, I don't want to talk about me. I want to talk about God. God's able to change your life, church. He's able to help us. And I want to tell you this. He is rejoiced in his church. He is glorified in his church. We do rejoice in God, even in this lost and dying world. Listen, that God is our King and he's our Lord. But I want to tell you this. Someday, the whole world is going to fall down before him. The whole world. Right? And they don't get to vote on it. Right? They don't get to vote on it. They don't get to make the rules. God has already made the rules. I love you. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know it. Oh, I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Amen. Amen. I love you. The altar's always open, always is. And if you have a need in your life, you can come this way. Oh, but I love you and I care about you. And we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again for your grace and your mercy and your love and the hope that we have in our heart. Lord, thank you for forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, for making a way. Lord, that when your Holy Spirit moves in our heart and our life and conviction sets in, that we can get things right. That we can be saved. That we can be near to you, dear God. What a blessing it is that you have made a way. That your scripture tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Lord, we love you. But we love you because you first loved us. You found us. You seen that we were lost. You seen that we had come short. Oh, Jesus, and you willingly died on the cross to pay for my sins. My sins. You suffered. All that you suffered for my sin. Lord, I don't want to take that for granted. But I want to be near to you. And your righteousness reign in my life. Thank you, Jesus, for changing our hearts, for changing our lives. We do love you. So thankful you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We love you. We hope you have a blessed day. And continue to pray for the sick. In the fear of the Lord, we're separated.